हेलो, टुडे वी शैल सी द कंसेप्ट ऑफ ओपनिंग। फर्स्ट लेट अस सी द नीड फॉर ब्लोरूम एंड द कार्ड। द स्पिनिंग ऑफ द यार्न फ्रॉम कॉटन फाइबर्स रिक्वायर्स दैट द मटेरियल इज इन एन ओपन एंड अ प्रोसेसेबल फॉर्म, बट द मटेरियल एंटर्स द मिल इन द फॉर्म ऑफ अ बेल दैट इज हाईली कंप्रेस्ड, एंड द कंप्रेस्ड बेल इज मेड फ्रॉम द पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू ऑफ ईज ऑफ ट्रांसपोर्टेशन एज वेल एज स्टोरेज। Here there is an image of the bales that are kept, and there is a human being over here, a man. We can judge the size of the bale that is there around him, and so this picture is indicative of the kind of weight this bale contains. So let us go ahead and see the two levels of opening that are identified. The opening to the flocks that is achieved by Blorum, and opening to fibers that is achieved by the card. So let us see the importance of Blorum. The process of Blorum is important because it has quite a lot of influence on the quality of the raw material. A good Blorum would allow for a cheaper material to be used while maintaining the yarn quality. Since the raw material accounts for 50 to 70% of the yarn costs, a good Blorum line has a great potential for savings. A conventional Blorum line and a card that is old may lead to a deterioration of quality and yarn breakages by around 50%. So let us go ahead and see the objects of Blorum. Opening of the material into tufts, cleaning of the material by eliminating most of the impurities, dust removal, blending, and even feed of material to the card. These are the objects of Blorum. And with this, we take a look at the first two objects, that is opening and cleaning. So cleaning can only happen from the surfaces. New surfaces must therefore be continuously created. This is the basic concept of opening and cleaning. So any cleaning to happen, it is always necessary that new surfaces are created, because cleaning happens only from the surface. So, and also one must take care that newly created surfaces must be immediately cleaned, because if they are not done so, then during transportation again the surfaces might get covered with whatever trash that has been removed. They may again settle down on the surfaces, and further cleaning might become difficult. So as soon as at any stage opening happens, cleaning must immediately be following this kind of an opening. So opening and cleaning of cotton using only one machine is therefore difficult, and due to the need for continuous improvement, we have seen that one needs to keep on improving the opening level, and therefore opening and cleaning with just one machine is highly difficult. So one would require a series of machines in the Blorum. The raw material enters the mill in a highly compressed form, in the form of a bale, and therefore it has to be opened before any cleaning that can be carried out by opening this particular bale. So what are the various devices that one might see in the Blorum? There are rollers, there are drums, there are shafts, there are multiple bladed beaters, spiked lattices, pickers, as well as carding bars or plates. So the various opening devices found in the Blorum are, as mentioned, rollers, drums, beaters, spiked lattices, as well as pickers. These devices open the feed material and assist in cleaning a process by both breaking apart and opening out of the material. We shall see both these words or these concepts later on, what is meant by breaking apart and what is meant by opening out. So with this, we go to the components of the Blorum machines that one may see during opening, that is spike lattice, gripping device, or rollers with spikes or teeth. The spiked lattice, as we can see over here, it is a belt-like system on which there are steel spikes that are there, and this particular belt would rotate in one particular direction. So they are forwarding and opening devices consisting of endless lattices or belt with transverse bars into which steel spikes are set. The steel spikes may be set at an angle, and the spacing between two adjacent spikes may vary. Inclined spike lattices feed the material upwards due to the spikes that pick the material. The spikes would pick the material, and if the lattice is moving in the upward direction, the material is picked up and taken upwards. These lattices are useful in opening since they pick up small tufts out of a large infield material. Offsetting the spikes relative to each other or increasing the speed or increasing number of spikes would increase the opening effect here. The opening effect is very, very gentle. So with this, we come to the second type of device, that is gripping device. They are plucking spring systems facing each other like a pair of jaws of a tong. They lift the material like fingers when parted and dropped into the material. So if these jaws are placed apart and dropped into the material, they would grip the fibers like fingers. It is very gentle in its action, but produces large to very large clumps of uneven sizes. Hence, one may not find this anymore in the blow room. Mainly because of the large size clumps as well as even sizes of the clumps that it produces. So coming to the rotating devices that one might find, the first one we shall look at is the toothed discs roller. So these discs have a triangular plucking elements, as one can see, and these discs are secured to the shaft with spacers. So these discs, in between them there is a space, and for that space spacers are used. Then we can look at the bladed beater. It consists of two or three bladed bars arranged parallel to the shaft and held by arms. These are the arms that hold these particular bars. The web coming out of the feed roller is subjected to two or three blows along the whole width during one rotation of the beater. So once if this beater were to rotate in any direction, the material is coming out of, say, the feed rollers, then it would subject it to two or three blows depending on how many blades are there on this particular beater. The opening and cleaning effect is small and hence they are not much in use. Then we come to a bladed drum, which has got flat oval or rounded bars that are welded, riveted or screwed to the closed cylinder. So there is another type that is there where drums with double pins are used. The double pins are fixed by screws to the drum surface. With this, we look at some more rotating devices, that is beaters with pinned bars. So in the earlier where it was a two or a three bladed beater, the bars were plain. Here it is pinned bars. On the surface you can see there are pins, and these pins allow for better opening. But it also eliminates a lot of fibers, and such beaters were known as Kirschner beaters. And a slightly modern version of it would be this design, where they are using a closed roller. In the earlier design, the material, there were chances that they get accumulated between two blades here and keep rotating along with the beater without really being opened out. So this closed design does not have any space for fiber accumulation and rotation along with the beater. So it's the design is simpler, and the flow conditions for the material are much more favorable. One may also have, instead of three, maybe six bars all over the circumference of this particular beater. So there is now we come to one more kind of rotating device, which is known as the takeoff roller with two-sided teeth. If in certain situation the roller needs to rotate in both clockwise as well as anti-clockwise direction during opening, in that case, if it has to be effective in both the directions, then it must have symmetric teeth that would be effective in both directions of rotation. So this kind of a teeth would be more favorable when this kind of a situation arises in any of the blow room machines. So with this, we try to understand the concept of opening. Since opening is very important for cleaning, there must be a way by which one can judge or calculate the quality of roving. The following two types of opening can happen during processing. That is, one is breaking apart, where two smaller flocks are formed from one large flock without any change in density. So here we are not talking about any change in density or volume, but just a bigger flock is made or divided into two smaller or four smaller flocks without any change in volume or density. The second type of opening can be opening out, which is volume of the flock is increased. So if a given number of fibers in a flock is there, and after processing, that particular flock might have the same weight, but the volume has increased. That means it has got opened out, and therefore the density might have reduced. So there are these two types of opening that can happen during the processing in blow room machines. So breaking apart would be sufficient for cleaning. Now, if the aim is only to clean, then breaking apart is sufficient. But if one needs to blend or align, then in that case, opening out is also necessary. When we come to blending, it is one of the objects of Bloroom, where fibers coming from different regions are brought together, they are mixed, and one is expecting a homogeneous mixture. So in that case, opening out is very helpful, and it also helps in loosening and releasing of trash particles that are embedded deep inside the fiber flocks. So how does one evaluate opening? So evaluation of opening, degree of opening, it is also known as degree of opening. So size of the flock, which is a measure of the breaking apart, and density, which is a measure of opening out, both these can be measured very easily to evaluate the degree of opening. So simply evaluated by measuring the weight per flock. So Bloroom, a sequence of different machines. Let us see why Bloroom is a sequence and not one single machine. To achieve the various objects that we have just seen, Bloroom, different machines are required. So also, due to the decreasing size of the tuft from one machine to the next machine, each machine would have different opening capacities. Their construction would be different, and from the point, like for example, spikes on the drums that we have just seen, the elements, the spacing between the spikes, etc., the speeds, so many factors in a machine may change depending on what kind of opening capacities are needed. So therefore, since one needs to keep on improving the opening, either by breaking apart or opening out, the construction of the machine will change, and therefore one machine is not sufficient. Each machine is therefore constructed differently and must occupy its own position in the sequence for optimum performance. One may choose the number of machines in the Bloroom line sequence depending upon the characteristics of the raw material, like trash content, production, and variation in the raw material in terms of their properties. So one can always choose the number of machines. If the trash content, for example, in the material is high, in that case one may require more number of machines. And vice versa. So depending on the production levels that we're expecting or the variation in the raw material that is there, one may increase or reduce the number of machines in the Bloroom. If machines are not required in the sequence, they must not be used because there are chances that they may damage the fiber. So optimum number of machines must be selected. So let us take a look at the diagrammatic representation of degree of opening. Here we have a graph which shows the degree of dependence of the degree of opening on the throughput, that is the production of the machine. We have here on the y-axis A, and A is nothing but flock weight in milligrams, which gives us the degree of opening. And along x-axis, which is marked as B here, it shows us the production in kgs per hour. So there are three machines that are compared here: conventional and Uniflock A10 and Uniflock A11. These are return machines, and they are compared with a conventional machine on how the degree of opening is dependent on the production levels going through these machines. So the graph shows the dependence of opening of Uniflock as a function of material throughput. One can easily see over here that as the machine throughput or the production goes on increasing, simultaneously the flock weight, that is flock size that the machine produces, also increases. That means it is not able to do such a good job if one increases the production beyond limits. So also another thing that we can observe from this particular graph is that the conventional machine reduces the reduction in size that is happening in the conventional is not much as compared to the modern machines, that is Uniflock, both the Uniflocks over here. For the same production levels, as we can see, maybe we can just draw a vertical here anywhere, and we can find out that for the same production levels, the flock size in case of conventional would be more as compared to the any of the Uniflocks that are shown here. So a Uniflock would be able to reduce the size of the material to a higher extent as compared to the conventional. So with this, we come to one more graph which is shown over here, where it is comparing the flock size on the basis of the number of machines that are there in the Bloom sequence. So again, flock weight in grams per flock is shown on the y-axis, and one can observe that the flock size goes on reducing as we go along the y-axis. And on the x-axis, it is showing the number of machines in a sequence starting from feed material, and there are 5 machines that are shown. So increasing opening of the material from one Bloom machine to another, which is a Tutzler Bloom line, it is observed that machine number 4 and 5 do not reduce the weight of the flock any further. If you observe carefully over here, machine number 4 to 5, there it's almost flat, and there is no reduction in size as we see in the earlier machines. From the feed to the first machine, there is a considerable reduction in the flock size. From M1 to M2, again, we can see that there is a considerable reduction, but when it comes to 4 and 5, there is hardly any reduction in size that one can see. So such processes do not make any kind of contribution. They not only make the process expensive, but also stress the raw material in an unnecessary manner. So such machines, as far as possible, should not be there in the sequence. So therefore, machines can only be justified if they would open out the material. So along with breaking apart, if the material is being opened out, and that means a volume is being increased or a density is being lowered, in that case only such machines would be justified in the line. Otherwise, it is better to not to have them, because they would ultimately lead to damage of the fibers. Now we come to another graph. This shows the ideal form of opening curve as shown by Trutzler. It's a similar graph as earlier, but in this case we can see that at every stage there is some amount of flock size reduction that is happening right up to machine 6. So in this case, we can see from the graph that each and every machine is justified in being in the Bloom line. So let us with this come to the degree of opening Bloom and card, to what level they can open. In the Bloom, the tuft size can be reduced up to about 0.1 milligram. Whereas in the next process, that is carding, it is able to open the material to the level of individual fibers. The graph is based on that is shown here is based on a theoretical values. It shows the degree of opening in centimeters cube per gram. That is, it is a volume it is showing per gram, which is also known as specific volume, and it is shown at various stages of the Bloom line. It consists of a sequence of machines that achieve a higher degree of opening as compared to the previous machine. Each machine is able to increase the volume of this particular tuft, but after a certain level, we see maybe after machine number 4 or somewhere at 5, the graph literally flattens. So the flattening of the curve indicates that the improvement in the degree of opening are very small after machine number 4, and therefore the use of machines 5 to 10 will only add to the stress on the fibers. So unnecessary fiber loss, and also maybe to an increase in the nips. So it is better to avoid these kind of machines once we observe the graph that those machines give us. So there are various types of feed material that one can feed to the Bloom to get yarn. The feed material to the Bloom could be natural fibers or man-made fibers, including regenerated fibers. The raw material fed to the Bloom may be a mix of any of the following components that we shall see just now, along with maybe having any 2 fibers or 3 fibers from the earlier natural man-made categories. Along with that, maybe even the following components may be used. Like for example, the first and foremost feed material that comes is from the raw fiber that comes from the ginning mill, or the man-made fibers that comes from the manufacturer. One can also have clean waste that is taken from the same spinning line. It could be coming from broken sliver ends, lap or web. Then there can be fibers coming from hard waste. It is known as hard waste because some amount of twist is inserted at these stages in case of roving yarn or doubled yarn. So hard waste fibers that are extracted from this kind of waste can also be used as a feed material. Then there one can have filter waste that comes from draw frame, roving frame, ring frame and rotor spinning. Now here rotor spinning is a different spinning method to make yarns, and it gives rotor spun yarns. So in this case, filter based of rotor spinning may also be used as one of the sources of raw material, but to a very small extent. All the other sources other than raw fiber are used, but they are used to a very small extent. Also, some amount of recycled waste from dirty waste in blow room and card may also be used. Then there is one more kind of clean waste coming from Kumbar, which is also known as Noil. This kind of waste is only used in case of feed to the for rotors, making of rotor spun yarns on a rotor spinning machine, which is a entirely a different method of spinning yarns, which probably we can learn at a later stage. So percentage of waste that are produced at various stages of spinning, it's this table is an indicative table of the percentage of waste that is found at various stages of spinning. So starting with blow room here, it can go from 6 to maybe 5, 4 or even 3 as the material or the length of the cotton becomes larger or greater. That means the material has become better. So waste extracted would be lower in case of blow room. Similar trend one can see in the case of card. The waste extracted at sliver lap, ribbon lap is very less. In the case of Kumbar, it goes up to 12% because we are extracting noil here, which consists of short fibers. There is a small percentage of waste that one may see at draw frame, that is 0.6. Roving frame, it is 1, and ring frame, it is around 1.5 for a cotton of around 1 inch length. So raw fiber is better always than waste fibers, because the waste fibers, whatever source it may be, they are always processed, and due to the processing, they are subjected to different levels of stress, and because of which they would undergo some kind of changes in the characteristics. Also, depending on the stage from which they are picked or taken, each fiber, since they come from different sources, will vary when you compare with each other in their characteristics. So such a mix of inhomogeneous feed material shall lead to a final yarn count and quality variations. So if we were to use feed material from waste fibers from different sources, then one can easily find a lot of quality variations in the final yarn. And it is not advisable to use the waste fibers in huge proportions in the feed material for blow room. So proportion of various components in the feed material, so exactly how much one should use. Mostly raw cotton and man-made fibers are used along with a small proportion of clean waste and possibly some amount of recycled fibers. Also, the percentage of waste fibers added must be fixed along with the fixed proportion of waste coming from the different sources. So what is being said here is, if we are planning to use waste fibers, then the proportion or the percentage must be fixed right from the beginning, and it should be consistent. And also, within that waste, whatever percentage we have fixed, the proportion of waste coming from different sources also must be fixed, so that we get a consistent quality throughout. Only clean waste from sliver, lap or web and recycled waste in limited quantities only may be added to the same feed for yarn. So suppose if you are processing one, say, particular quality of yarn, whatever waste is generated in its spinning line, the waste coming only from sliver, lap or web and some amount of recycled waste can be used in the as feed for that particular yarn. That means it can be again reused. But whatever hard waste we get from rovings from any particular quality, the hard waste should not be used for the same yarn, but it can always be used for making of a lower quality yarn. Even recycled waste can be added only in the following small proportions. For a ring spun yarn of carded quality, up to 5% may be added, recycled waste may be added. For a combed ring spun yarn, only 2.5% may be added. But for rotor spun yarns in coarse medium, up to 20% may be added. For medium, up to 10, and for fine, around 5% may be added. So with this, we come to the conditioning or acclimatization of the fibers. The air temperature in the blow room should be above 23 degrees Celsius and the relative humidity should be in the range of 45 to 50%. Let us see why this kind of standards are should be maintained in the blow room. Because damp air would lead to poor cleaning and dry air would lead to fiber damage. So the condition of the air is important because the fibers, whenever they are kept in these conditions for some time, they adapt to the conditions that it is exposed to. So cotton bales, as soon as it comes to the mills, they should be left to stand in an opened state for at least 24 hours. For better results, it should be left for 48 hours before processing, so that the fibers will adapt itself to the conditions of the blow room, the atmospheric conditions, and therefore processing would become easier. In case of man-made fibers, they must be left to stand in an unopened state, which is very important. It should not be opened, unlike a cotton. It should be left in an unopened state for at least 48 hours before processing. This is because man-made fibers tend to have some kind of condensation on them, because as they warm up, they come from cold environment to a warm environment, and condensation is a danger. So one must keep it in an unopened state for at least 48 hours before processing. So let us look at the bale layout, or the number of bales that one must select to get a homogeneous mix. To get a homogeneous feed from different sources, which we have just seen, it is necessary that 20 to 48 bales are opened simultaneously. Since the fibers come from, even the raw fiber that one might use come from different areas, different regions, and fibers coming from different regions are different in their characteristics. So to get a homogeneous mix, one must be careful in opening as large amount of bales as because larger the number of bales opened, one might get a more better homogeneous mixture. So around 20 to 48 bales are generally opened. For obtaining a consistent feed every time, the bales must be chosen in such a way that the fibers in those bales have similar average values for various fiber characteristics. So to get those bales, to get a consistent mix every time, one must choose all these fibers in a very systematic manner by considering all the fiber characteristics of the cotton in those bales. So therefore, the quality of the bales must be known and they must be carefully selected for optimum bale grouping. One must not take varied characteristics for grouping them. The grouping should be done on the basis of similar values, average values of different bales coming from different regions. So we come to the feed to the blow room machines. The feed to the blow room machines can be in free flight, or it can also happen in clamped condition or a gripped condition. So feeding in free flight would be like dropping the material through a transport duct, or pulling it through a suction pipe or a vortex transport from the rollers. Whereas feeding in a gripped or a clamped condition would mean that we require special components on the machine, which we shall see in the coming slides. Another point of comparison is that whenever material is fed in free flight, the machine gives a gentler treatment but less intensive treatment to the fibers. Whereas when feeding is happening in a clamped condition, it gives a intensive treatment, but the treatment at the same time is less gentle, or rather it is harsh in treatment towards the fiber. So one must always consider the kind of treatment that our fiber that we are going to use requires. If the fiber is delicate, then one must always go for pre-flight feeding, so that one so that gentle treatment is given and fibers are not damaged, and vice versa. So feeding in a clamped condition, so this type of feeding system used influences the opening and the cleaning. There are basically three types of feeding systems. The first one is the two roller feed system, and this is the beater. So two rollers gives the best forward motion. That means the material coming out would be the would be coming in a secure way, but greatest clamping distance between roller nip and beater. So one can see here the roller nip, that is the grip that this roller set of rollers provide, and the beater, the distance is quite huge in between them. So there is a second option with us where we have a feed plate and a roller feeding system, and one can see that the distance between the grip and the beater has reduced drastically. So feed roller and feed plate, it gives us a small clamping distance, but it gives intensive opening but poor clamping along the width, because along the width it may not be able to grip with the same pressure. It is able to clamp only at the highest places on the web, while the thinner portions can be just dragged out as clumps by the beater. So coming to the third type, which is an improvement over the second, we have these this feed plate divided into sections here, and they are fulcrumed, and on one side there is a spring. So if the spring were to pull this particular side downwards, then the other side would be gripping the material in between itself and the roller more securely. So each section would be independently controlling or gripping the material between them. So this type of system, which is known as feed roller and pedals, in this feed plate is divided into many sections, each one individually pressing the web using spring pressure. It has got small clamping distance just like before, but at the same time the drawback that was there, it has been taken care of, because it gives a secure pressure along the entire width of the web. So we have seen three types of feeding that one may come across in the blow room machines. So with this, we look at the intensity of opening. The level of opening achieved in the blow room depends on the raw material, the thickness and the density of feed, fiber coherence and alignment, as well as the size of the flock. So to give an example, more the thickness of the raw material that is being fed, maybe the level of opening would be lower in that case. So depending on each of these factors, if fiber coherence, for example, is too high, then level of opening may not be achieved to a large extent. In the same way, the size of flock or the density of the feed, everything will influence the level of opening. Then the other factor that influences level of opening is the machine used, the type, the form of feed, the type of opening device, the clothing, its point density, arrangement and spacing between the feed and the opening device. All this will matter, and all this will influence the level of opening achieved in the blow room. So also the speeds of the machine and the material, along with the atmospheric humidity and temperature, all these factors one must consider when we need to see the level of opening that can be achieved by any of the blow room machines. So with this, we come to the topic of blow room zones, where now we have understood that to achieve the various objects of blow room, the five objects, that is opening, cleaning, blending, dust removal, and even feed to the card, we need to have a sequence of machines of different types and construction in the sequence. And so it would be easier for us if we were to divide these machines based on their construction and the type of object that is achieved by it, or rather the intensity with which the opening or the cleaning is taking place. If we were to divide these machines into various zones and study them in as various zones, it would be much easier for us to understand the entire topic. So it may be roughly divided into six zones as given below. The first type of machines that would come in the sequence would be the bale, because the bale is coming into the mill. So bale opening would be the first object. So there would be machines for bale opening. After this, once the opening has happened, the next stage is cleaning, and that would be coarse cleaning. Third would be blending. If the material is coming from different regions, they need to be blended. So one must use machines in the sequence that are specifically meant for blending. Then there would be machines which one would find for intermediate cleaning, and then maybe for fine cleaning. And lastly, one must have one of the objects of blow room is to have an even feed to the card. So there must be some machines at the end of the sequence which would achieve this aim of feeding to the card. So roughly the blue room zones are the blue room line is divided into six zones that is just mentioned here. So with this we come to the end of this lecture on concept of opening and an introduction to blue room. Thank you.